Let's keep in mind that this is not the 6-speed manual. This is the automatic, 8-speed automatic from ZF, if I'm not wrong. But you guys can see it's very responsive on the gear shifts. Hey guys, I'm Rich. Welcome to Rich with Cars. On this week's episode, I'm going to be going over this amazing G87 M2. It's been a while that I've been wanting to actually get a chance to review this car and get a chance to drive it. Of course, there's been plenty of reviews out there. Let's not forget that this M2 or this generation M2 actually has the same engine as the current generation M3 and M4. So we got quite a powerful little beast over here. And if you guys are new to the channel, make sure to check out some of my older content where I review similar cars to this and some other luxury vehicles. So as always, guys, let's dive in, take a look at this M2, where I go over some of the exterior design, interior design, engine, cargo overview, and of course, as always, driving impressions. So guys, let's strap in and take a look. The G87 M2 ended up coming out in 2023. I believe it was released in April of 2023 as a 2023 model year. And the M2 that we have here in front of us is the one that came in the launch color. It's called Zandvoort Blue. I absolutely love this color just because it's got sort of a very similar vibe to the Porsche Miami Blue. It really also helps in terms of accentuating the lines of the vehicle. Let's go over some of the changes and very controversial changes. At the beginning, everybody was not really a big fan of it. I'm still trying to get used to it, but it grew on me quite a bit. Is these, as you can see, squared off air intakes in the front. Everything in the front seems to be very squared off, including the typical kidney grill. The only thing that I'm not crazy about is the horizontal slats. I don't know if you guys can see, but you see that it has horizontal slats, and that even comes on the M3 and the M4. But I wish they would have kept the traditional vertical slats. I think you can actually get those aftermarket for the M2. And then of course we have a massive, massive opening here for additional cooling. The only thing that I'd be afraid of, to be honest, is that these openings that you can see over here, they don't have any sort of mesh grill. So you, like, if you're going really fast on the track or on the highway, this is hitting directly onto your radiator. Any owners out there that are taking a look at this, have owned this car for quite some time, let me know in the comments below, because I'm curious to know if you've had any issues with that. The other really cool thing that I love is this little bulge that you see on the hood. It really gives it sort of a mean look. And then of course, let's not forget, this was part of the 2 Series redesign, the front headlights. I really enjoy this daytime running light. It's like a, I guess like a not atypical shape for BMW. Typically the BMWs have sort of like the rings in the front. This is very different and very telling of the 2 Series now, especially for this M2. If you take a look at the vehicle from this angle right here, is the beautiful thing that I like over the M4, which is the bigger brother to the M2, is the fact that it accentuates the fenders. They're much more prominent than they are in the M4. I don't know if you guys can see on this angle, but I think here on the front, it really is, really pops out quite a bit. And also there in the rear, you get to see how much it really pops out. I would personally probably go for an M2 over the M4 just because of that. And you get to see it even more on this angle right here. Then of course you got very similar design wheels on this M2, which is similar to the M4 and the M3. These are 19s. Your prototypical M design side view mirrors with this blade here at the top. You get a carbon fiber roof, which is also quite typical of M cars. I do like the fact that on the M2 now, you have a flush door handle design. It helps a lot for aerodynamics. And then you just basically slip your hand right under there to open the door. Everything seems to be very angular, including like even the rear fender flare. You could see how it basically angles out. The rear wheels are a different size than the front wheels. The rear wheels are 20-inch as opposed to the front being 19, so you do have a full staggered wheel setup. Now, I think this is probably the most controversial part of the M2. Taillights, I would say, are relatively nice. I'm not a big fan of them, but the most controversial part, I would say, is the rear bumper shape. You guys can see over here, they're really squared off, especially over here. I mean, I don't understand why they went so squared off, but on the flip side, I love what they did with the rear diffuser area, especially the exhaust tips. They are massive. It gives it a lot of presence from the rear, and it gives it a much more planted look as well. So ultimately, the overall design of the M2 is very controversial. I really do like the exterior design of the M2. It's got, my opinion, much more presence than it did to the previous generation. So getting into the BMW, let's take a look at the key. It's your typical, I guess, BMW M key. Nothing too special. You got a bit of brushed aluminum on the outer edge area. You got the M colors here on the side, and then you have your unlock, lock, trunk, release, and then your panic button. So when you unlock the door, the side view mirrors unfold. You're greeted by an M2 door sill over here in brushed aluminum design. And then looking at the door card itself, we do have sort of like, I guess, a little design with the M colors right here. This actually lights up at night, which is pretty cool. You got your memory seats, door lock unlock. Of course, your door release, which is manually operated instead of electronically operated. Your window controls and your side view mirror controls. I do like the fact that you do have some space over here. You have space for a bottle over here. You can put even like up to a 750 ml bottle. And then you have additional space right there for additional bottles or other items that you can put in there. It's relatively large. So being a small coupe, it's actually quite convenient. And then of course you have your trunk release over there. Being an M car, I do love the fact that you have brushed aluminum pedals with some grippy rubber in the middle. Let's take a look at the seat really quickly. These are not the carbon bucket seats. I prefer actually these seats than the carbons, because the carbons, even though they look incredible, I've sat inside of them a couple times, and I can't say that they're super comfortable. I can't imagine it being very comfortable on long drives. I do like the fact that like on any M car, you have the M2 badging here right on the headrest. And then the really cool thing is, in all this sea of black leather, you do have some M colors right along the side. So you have your red, your light blue, and then you have your dark blue right on the headrest, which is really cool. It gives it a little change of look and design on a black seat. You do have a thigh extension support over here. I did sit on these seats for a little while. I wouldn't say that I took them for a long drive, but so far they were very, very comfortable, to be honest. We have a gorgeous three-spoke steering wheel with carbon fiber inlays. I do like the fact that the carbon fiber goes all the way down here with the little M logo. And then you have, of course, the carbon fiber shift paddles right behind the steering wheel. They are steering wheel mounted as opposed to column mounted. These are not fully in carbon fiber. You have the carbon fiber front face, and the rear is a rubberized material. I guess it's for better grip. And then of course you have your M1 and M2 buttons, which help in terms of choosing your drive modes, which you can program. Now the gauge cluster, I would say that is a little bit unconventional in the way that it looks, just because it's not your prototypical sort of rings or anything like that. It's a sort of like a hexagonal type of shape, super customizable. There's a lot of different things that you can go through. I'd probably have to do an entire video on how you can customize your gauge cluster. I haven't had a chance to really go through everything. So I can change even like the content over here to the map. Different, that's your drive mode setup, your different engine readings, that's your tire pressure and your temperatures, your horsepower and pounds per foot of torque that's being used. That's your G meter, media radio. The infotainment screen, as you guys can see over here, we have Android Auto, but then you can go to your home. And the way that it's set up here, it's very customizable once again. So if I wanna go, these are all your apps. Very responsive as well. You have all kinds of different apps that you can get into. If I go back home, for example, you can even see the different tiles on the home page, and you can even modify this or customize this as well, whichever way you want. That's like your BMW, for example, all the different settings that you have, like I said, your vehicle apps. And then if I want to, You, like I said before, you can even add a widget. The climate menu is integrated into the infotainment screen. The cool thing is you have your temperature controls. You always have this button over here that allows you to get into the climate menu, and then you can basically adjust all your different climate settings. It would have been nice to have a few more climate physical buttons. The only ones that you have at the bottom are your rear defroster and your maximum front windshield defroster as well. And then you have a few other line items over here, like your volume knob, and then your next and previous track alongside with your hazards. Your BMW M gear selector, which is now seen in the M3 and M4s as well. Your engine start stop. You have another line item of different controls over here. Traction control off, your parking sensors, automatic start stop. Of course, your engine start stop. That's your mode selector for your drive mode. So if I press on that, you can basically choose out of different drive modes. That allows you to set up your customizable drive modes, I guess. And you can customize as much as your engine, chassis, steering, and brake. Believe it or not, they started doing brake as well, even for the M2 as well. And you can even modulate how much traction control assistance you get. The last thing is your exhaust. So I just press it, so that closed the exhaust valves. Press it again, so that opened up the exhaust valves. And that's your brake auto hold. So that basically allows you to just put your foot on the brake and it'll hold the brake when you're at a traffic light. Automatic parking brake. And then let's not forget the transmission. It's a ZF-HP transmission, which allows you also to modulate as well the quickness of the shifts alongside with your parking selector over here. And then that's your iDrive control. These are shortcut buttons. So if you just press home over here, it brings you to the home screen on the infotainment screen as well. You have all this carbon fiber inlays. I'm not a big fan of the fact that your dash behind the massive infotainment screen is all plastic injected mold, but this is an entry-level M car. You guys can see that the owner does have a baby seater here in the rear, so if any of you are curious to know if it does hold a baby seat, you do have quite a bit of space in the rear. You could put some small adults or some small children in the rear. This compared to, let's say, a Lexus RCF or even an LC500, which are both bigger vehicles from the exterior than the M2, do have less space than the M2 here in the rear. So kind of gives you an idea, guys, this is quite practical for being a small two-door coupe. There's different ways that you can open it up. One was through the key, the other one's from the interior, the button that's right on the door, and then there's also a little rubberized button over there as well. Quite impressive, to be honest, for a small two-door coupe in terms of space. Nothing too special in terms of the fact that you have anything out of the ordinary here. You do have a little cargo net on the left side. I'll show you guys on the screen what the cargo volume is for the M2. And then the other really cool thing is the fact that you do have seat release handles on each side. So that means that you can actually push down the rear seats to give you additional space for the trunk. So you can even put larger items in the rear. And then the other thing also is the fact that generally the opening for the trunk is pretty big. More and more, this car seems to be more of an attractive vehicle for those that wanna basically have a sporty vehicle that can also be daily driven and used for convenience purposes. Inside the engine bay of the G87 M2, if you guys are not familiar, the M2 does have the exact same engine as the M3 and M4, which is the S58, but this one in the M2 is slightly detuned. It does have 453 horsepower and 406 pounds per foot of torque, if I'm not wrong, but I will put the numbers on the screen for you guys. And I also put some of the top speed, 0 to 60 numbers. This is an amazing engine. I'm so happy that BMW decided to put the S58 in the M2. You get considerable more power than you did in the previous M2. Let's not forget also that this generation of M2 is slightly heavier than the previous gen. It's slightly larger as well. And there is reason behind that. But at the same time, the fact that you do have the S58 also does allow you to modify it quite a bit and bring it up to some crazy horsepower numbers. You can easily go over 500 in the mid fives with just a few bolt-ons, and you'd be just a little rocket ship, if anything. And then the other cool thing is that the fact that you have the strut brace that surrounds the engine and allows for additional rigidity as well. So guys, driving the G87 M2, so far my impressions have been very good on the vehicle. Let's keep in mind that this is not the 6-speed manual. This is the automatic, 8-speed automatic from ZF. You guys can see it's very responsive on the gear shifts. So another really cool thing that I just noticed while driving the car, guys, is that when you do have it in manual mode, you do have shift lights that come here on the gauge cluster when you're getting close to the red line. Now I can tell you that the shift, I mean not the shift, but the steering feel is very soft, but also extremely direct. As you guys can see, I'm also basically steering very quickly from side to side, and it's very, very direct. In terms of suspension feel, this particular M2 was switched to the M Competition coilovers. So it doesn't have the OEM suspension that comes with a vehicle. It does have a little bit stiffer, and at the same time, they're adjustable. So the suspension feel is gonna be a little bit different than the OEM M2, for example. And I can tell you guys that it does feel a little bit stiff. I wouldn't say uncomfortably stiff. It's a feeling that is stiff enough that will give you confidence as you're driving it, let's say on the track, which I presume is why BMW made the M Competition coilovers available for those that want to track this vehicle. And to tell you the truth, the owner of this vehicle ended up getting those because he does track the vehicles. In terms of brakes, the other cool thing as well is the fact that the owner did put the M Competition brake pads. Because the compound of the brake pad is a little bit more metallic and more aggressive, you will get quite a bit of brake squeal. I can tell you guys that for those of you that are considering, let's say, the M Competition brake pads and the M Competition coilovers, that it's, I can't say that I'm able to compare it to the OEM, but for those of you that do want it, I believe that it would be a better choice for you if you are planning on tracking the car. If you're just gonna be driving the car on regular roads and not really doing any type of competition driving, for example, or track driving, then I wouldn't do it, to be honest. Especially with the brakes, they're extremely noisy, and the suspension, frankly speaking, unless you're looking to, you know, get more direct type of feel or better contact patch on the road while as you're driving, I wouldn't opt for those. Now you can go for a suspension also that is aftermarket as opposed to the M Competition coilovers, which also provides you with better performance at the end of the day. The ZF transmission on this is very fast. You guys heard it there, that's for sure. It's very impressive. This definitely pushes like there's no tomorrow. There's slight turbo lag, but once your turbos kick in, wow, you better hold on to the steering wheel because you're gonna get pinned back to the seat, that's for sure. And of course, there's gonna be a little bit more turbo lag on the higher gears. So when you're going to from first to second and second to third on manual mode, you do get a bit of a punch from the gear changes, especially when you're in manual mode. And I personally like that because it kind of gives you a sort of like a more aggressive feel on the vehicle. Yeah, generally speaking, I would say that this car is very playful. Definitely, I would say it's probably more playful than the M4 because it's a smaller size, but it's got the same engine. So you got the benefits of a powerful engine with a smaller sort of vehicle to play with. And of course, it's got a shorter wheelbase as well. So it does tend to be a little bit more maneuverable. I'm very impressed with this car, and I'm very happy for my friend that he got it because he's gonna have a lot of fun driving this on the track. So guys, I hope you enjoyed this review on the BMW G87 M2. I'm super happy I got a chance to take some time with it, drive it. I was very impressed with the driving of this vehicle. I can understand why a lot of people really enjoy this car. I haven't had a chance to drive the new M3 or M4, but I'm sure that this probably is very similar, very close to those other two vehicles. And if it was me, with my money, especially with the convenience, the space, and of course, now that you have the same engine as in the M3 and M4, I'd probably go with this, personalize it the way that I want to, and just enjoy this. It's got a smaller frame in general, and it's a little bit more maneuverable, I would say. The M4, for example, which is the bigger brother coupe, is more of a GT car, if anything, I would say, with a lot of good performance as well. Let me know in the comments below what you guys think about the M2, and let me know if you guys have any questions about it. I really love this color, by the way. And as always, guys, thank you very much for all the views. I want to thank my buddy for allowing me to review this car. Make sure to give it a like, subscribe, and I'll see you guys on the next one. Take care. Bye-bye.